us a very wonderful afternoon to every one of you out there under the sound of my voice. It's another exciting time once again. 2:18 p.m. Nigerian time in the studios of King FM 103.9. And it's right about time to bring you that exciting show, editorial show on radio. King FM 103.9 once again. World in Review is the name of the program. Hi, my name is Ajibola Samuel, your regular host on the show. Good afternoon, everyone. Welcome on board. Yeah, once again, a very wonderful afternoon to you out there under the sound of a voice. To all Muslim brothers and Muslim sisters out there, Baraka de Jumo, like we always say in this part of the world, Jumo's Mubarak. This is World in Review once again on King FM 103.9. I'm Ajibola Samuel. In case you have just joined us for the first time on the show, we bring you the best news that made the rounds throughout the course of the week in the international scene. That's the underlying word, in the international scene. We try to break it down to you, bring some couple of insights, give you in-depth analysis so as to have a perfect understanding of what's going on around the world. Once again, my name is Ajibola Samuel, and the next couple of minutes, I'm going to be bringing you the various news that trended in the international scene throughout the course of this week. Welcome on board once again. Yeah, moving forward quickly, let's start from the African scene like we always do every Friday. And starting from the African continent, quite a lot of interesting stories coming up from the continent. Earlier this week, there was a rerun election that was held in a particular state, in a particular country in Africa. June 23 precisely, June 23, 2020, rerun elections were held in Malawi. Okay, going back in time, taking you back in time, last year, May 2019, presidential elections were held in Malawi, and it was a major standoff between the incumbent president, Peter Mutharika, and one of the strongest opposition. His name is Lazarus Chakwera. Eventually, after the elections, results came out, and Peter Mutharika was declared the winner with a little bit of over 38% of the votes. At the end of the day, the opposition, which is Lazarus Chakwera, took the decision and the results to court, challenging the results of the election that was held in May 2019. Fast forward to February 2020, the court gave its ruling, and the court actually annulled the election that was held in Malawi last year, May. The results cited various irregularities, especially the use of correctional fluid, like I said last week on the show. And if you don't understand what correctional fluid is, Tipex, we popularly call it Tipex here. It was reported that correctional fluid, which is Tipex, was used on the election results, and there are quite a whole lot of various irregularities that occurred in the elections. So they declared the election null and void, and they ordered that there be a fresh rerun elections organized within 150 days. That judgment was given in February 2020. And just some couple of months down the line, the rerun elections were held in Malawi on the 23rd of June 2020. Yeah, official results are not out yet. Results are still expected, but according to a state media in Malawi, it is being reported that Lazarus Chakwera, who is the opposition figure, is actually leading. They are not official results once again. They are just results probably that the state media got. The name of the state media is MBC, Malawi Broadcasting Corporation. Yeah, Malawi's opposition is claiming victory in the rerun of last year's presidential election, which was held again after allegations of widespread rigging. Official results for Tuesday poll have not yet been declared by the Malawi Electoral Commission, but state broadcaster MBC says opposition leader Lazarus Chakwera is leading with 59% of the votes. President Peter Mutharika, who wants a second term, has 38%, says the broadcaster. A third candidate, who was not regarded as a serious contender, his name is Peter Kuwane, is said to have received less than 2% of the votes. So once again, according to reports, not official results yet. The official results can only be announced by the Malawi Electoral Commission. But this is from the state broadcaster MBC in Malawi, saying that Lazarus Chakwera, who is the opposition party candidate, and by the way, some popular party came together to appoint him as the flag bearer of the party, more like there was a merger between different parties. So Lazarus Chakwera, the main opposition contestant, is reported to be leading with about 59% of the vote. An incumbent president, President Peter Mutharika, is said to have just 38%, while another candidate who is not regarded as a serious contender, his name is Peter Kuwane, is reported to have just gotten just about 2% of the vote. So official results are expected to come in the coming days, and as the story develops, we bring to you the official results and the official announcements of the winner of the votes in Malawi. Okay, leaving the Malawi right now, this time around I'm in South Africa, and it's funny and surprising how things are turning out in South Africa just some couple of days after they've entered another phase of easing of lockdown and restrictions in that country. And the news is that more than 180 South African pupils, secondary school students, primary school students, test positive at coronavirus hotspots. Yeah, scrambling to contain a coronavirus outbreak at a school in Eastern Cape Province after about 180 pupils tested positive. Makaula Senior Secondary School was closed on Tuesday for decontamination. Officials say contact tracing and testing is underway. Yeah, Eastern Cape Province has so far closed 196 schools since President Cyril Ramaphosa ordered the reopening of schools on June 21 for older students. The coastal province is the second hardest hit in South Africa in terms of COVID-19 related deaths, with more than 300 fatalities. The neighboring Western Cape Province has recorded 1,500 out of the country's 1,990 total deaths. So students were actually allowed to resume on the 1st of June, and it has led to a surge and an increase in the number of positive cases, especially among students. And this has led to a movement in South Africa. South African teachers are now protesting that schools should be closed again. A free principal have written an open letter to the president, Cyril Ramaphosa, urging him to rethink the decisions to open schools. They say that virus cases within the community are now affecting pupils and teachers. According to the Western Cape Education Department, over 300 staff members and 61 people has tested positive for the coronavirus. Some teachers refused to report back to work after colleagues tested positive for virus, according to reports. The Western Cape is the worst hit province in the country, with almost 50% of South African cases. The morning's demonstration was actually covered by the media, and I will try to bring you excerpts from the reports of the from the protest ground, the protest that happened in South Africa, that schools should be closed again due to the fact that both teachers and students are actually testing positive for coronavirus.
Our question to the Department of Education is that how come you open schools while we know that there is no safety in schools when it comes to the risk of our children? For us, this is an indication that tells us that this is becoming a crisis to working class areas.
What you are saying, the Department of Education must focus on matriculants. They must quarantine them and test them and take them to campsites where they will not, in that campsite, they won't learn with these masks that are uncomfortable. They won't have to use sanitizers because it will be a close range, a close environment whereby they'll be able to learn. Schools are not safe. People, you are gambling with the lives of teachers, you are gambling with the lives of our members, you are gambling with the life of learners, of innocent scholars. So we have gave a mandate to say that schools need to be shut down, and they must communicate to everyone on Friday that the schools are shutting down. Arrogant schools such as your own.
Yeah, of course, you heard it from the SS Smart there, the various teachers in Western Cape province of South Africa, the hardest hit province in South Africa when it comes to coronavirus, coming out to tell the governments to close down schools again because it's not safe, not only for the pupils, but for the teachers also. Okay, moving forward, still in Southern Africa, but in another country in South Africa. And Zimbabwe's anti-corruption body starts audits of the rich. Yeah, Zimbabwe authorities say people who cannot explain where their wealth came from are in danger of having their assets seized, even if courts clears them of corruption allegation. The new operation, which is an intensive lifestyle audit of the rich, said the chairman of the Zimbabwe's Anti-Corruption Commission, Justice Lois Matanda Moyo. The country is facing its worst economic crisis in more than a decade. There is a mounting public anger over poor services and corruption. Now, quoting the justice, he says, "This is an intensive lifestyle audit on some of the rich people. They have to produce their invoices on what goods or services they have rendered, and this has to match the value of the acquired properties. We will also be checking if these people or their businesses were paying taxes." The operation is using powers the commission gained July 2019 to demand an explanation for how people earned their wealth, known as an unexplained wealth order. Yeah, quite an interesting news. In case you don't understand what they are trying to do, they are planning an intensive lifestyle audit. Okay, trying to break it down. Let's say you have two cars, you have three houses, and you have some couple of other properties. What the anti-corruption body is planning to do right now is that they are going to come to you and they're going to say, "Young man, sit down. What business are you doing? Let's look at how much your business is making for you. If it is from those businesses that you were able to buy the cars and the houses and the wealth that you were able to acquire." And according to reports, from what they said, if it is probably found that from your businesses you probably made 100 naira and you have properties worth 1,000 naira, your properties can be seized even if the court clears you of corruption allegation. So if you are using two phones, you have to be able to account for the two phones that you are using. You have to be able to prove that you earned legally to be able to afford the phones, the cars, and the houses that you have. If you can't prove legally that your businesses made you those money, your assets are going to be seized, according to the Zimbabwe Anti-Corruption Commission. By the end of the Almighty, we found in this generation triumphantly. Won't you help the sinner? Okay, before leaving the African continent, that's all I ever had. major statistics as concerning the coronavirus in Africa. Statistics concerning the major the coronavirus in Africa. And the list I have with me is updated an hour ago. So talking about the African continent has had a total of 347,836 coronavirus cases. Once again, a total of 347,836 confirmed coronavirus cases. Now, talking about the active cases that we have 172,692. That's at the number of people with active coronavirus in their body. And talking about the people that have recovered fully from coronavirus in the African continent, 166,074. And the number of deaths recorded across Africa stands at 9,070. Yeah, we are streaming live on Facebook right now. In case you want to put a face to the voice that you are hearing right now, you can go to our Facebook fan page, King FM 1039 Ibadan. No space. They are to be reading together. King FM 1039 Ibadan. You are getting to get to watch me do this live in the studio, and we can run it together. Once again, King FM 1039 Ibadan. That is the official Facebook page of King FM 103.9. You can get to watch me do this live, and you can get to watch past and various editions of the shows that have been aired from the stables of King FM. So once again, before leaving the African continent, and the statistics of the coronavirus cases in Africa, confirmed cases stands at 347,836. Active cases stands at 172,692. And the number of people that have recovered stands at 166,074. Number of deaths all across Africa, 9,070. Okay, leaving the African continent, I'm in the United States of America this time around. There is hardly any edition of World in Review that you don't get news from the United States of America. And George Floyd, the man left us about a month ago, and stories encapsulated in what led to his death actually wouldn't leave the headlines. Keeps hugging the headlines, from the protests to the reform bills, to police brutality, protests all around the world. We've got something related to the George Floyd case once again. The thing that charmed me was the pain of the past. The charm. And I hope this charm is gonna last. Yeah, just some couple of days ago, about a week or a little over a week precisely, I read to you last week on the show how President Donald Trump actually signed an executive bill to reform police in the United States of America. And if you followed the show last week, we told you about the contents of that bill, how police departments in the United States of America are going to be exchanging data of people that are employed, how they are going to be making use of social workers to handle cases of people that are on drugs, and how they are going to ensure adequate training for police and how to properly train them in order not to, you know, handle cases like this and make it escalate once again. Yeah, quite a lot of controversies trailed that executive bill that was signed into law. Democrats and some oppositions to President Donald Trump in the United States coming out to say that, young man, President Donald Trump, you are just scratching the surface. You are not, you know, dealing with the root cause of this particular pandemic that has been affecting the U.S. society and the world for a couple of time. And just some couple of hours ago, the U.S. House Houston, the Democrats in the United States of America House of Representatives actually passes their own version of the police reform bill, and they call it George Floyd's police reform bill. Yeah, the U.S. House of Representatives has passed a sweeping police reform bill that currently has a little prospect of becoming law amid partisan gridlock. The Democratic Control Chamber voted 236 to 181 for the measure, mainly along party lines, on Thursday night. The legislation, once again, like I said earlier, is named after George Floyd. Now let's talk about what's in the Democratic House bill, the Democratic Party bill. The George Floyd's Justice in Policing Act, that's the name of the bill. The George Floyd's Justice in Policing Act bill was passed exactly a month after the Minneapolis man's death. A rap speed for the usually deliberative and ponderous legislative body. Talking about the content of the bill, the Democratic bill would hold police officers personally liable for damages in lawsuits, ban no-knock warrants often used by police in drug raids, and halt the flow of military surplus equipment to police departments. Now listen once again, these are the things that the bill is meant to tackle. It's going to personally hold police officers liable for damages in lawsuits. Yeah, according to past events, most of the time when police actually do these things, they don't get necessarily punished for their actions. Most of the time, the punishment that they get is that they are dismissed by that police department, and after their dismissal, they have no job, no to work with. Most of the time, unlike what we are seeing with Cherek Chauvin, they are not usually taken to court and punished for that crime. Most of the time, the punishment that they get is only getting sacked by the police department. So this bill is saying that they will be held personally liable for damages in lawsuits. And also, ban no-knock warrants often used by police in drug raids. If you are going to have a drug raid, like, you know, police organized raids, or even in our country, if you want to go and raid a particular, let's say, cartel that you suspect of running drugs, police in the United States of America don't need arrest warrants, actually. They can actually work without warrants. So what they are now trying to address again is that they ban no-knock warrants often used by police in drug raids. And also, they are planning to halt the flow of military surplus equipment to police departments. So let's say the police and the military actually requested for their equipment that are surplus to military requirements in that country, they are usually given to the police departments to enable them function properly. So this particular bill is planning to address the passage of military, the flow of military surplus to police departments. Okay, let's take a quick trip to the United States of America, and we get to listen to how things went down when the votes was being casted in the House of Representatives.
On this let us unite, for life is worth much more than gold. We're charming, charming, charming. All I ever have. We're charming right straight from the
eye. 236, the nays are 181. The bill is passed. Without objection, the motion to reconsider is laid upon the table. On this vote, the yeas are 236. The nays are 181. The bill is passed. Without objection, the motion to reconsider is laid upon the table. And what the subject at hand was the legislation, the Justice and Policing Act, to ensure that George's death, Breonna Taylor's death, Ahmaud Arbery's death, and so many others were not in vain. But you must know, but bears repeating, what this bill is about. It bans choke holds. That makes it different from some other bills that are around. It bans choke holds nationally. Stops no-knock warrants in case of drug cases. Ends qualified immunity doctrine that is a barrier to holding police officers accountable for wrongful conduct. Combats racial profiling. Mandates data collection, including body cameras and dashboard cameras, and establishes a new standard for policing, among other things. It also passes our anti-lynching bill, the Emmett Till bill, that had already passed the House, but that's in there as well.
Yeah, ladies and gentlemen, that is the voice of Nancy Pelosi, the Speaker of the House of Representatives in the United States of America, and coming to intimate us of the contents of the George Floyd Justice and Policing Reform Policing Act Reform Bill.
Holy Mount Zion, Holy Mount Zion, just seated in Mount Zion, it rules all creation everywhere.
Okay, moving forward quickly, still in the United States of America, President Donald Trump of the United States of America has been an advocate of stopping immigrants influxing into the country, and this is one of his main campaign policies and promises in the 2016 presidential election. If you did follow that election, you will hear him talking about building a wall around the South, in building a wall so that people wouldn't be able to penetrate the country. People coming from this Mexico and other South American, North American countries would not be able to infiltrate that country. So President Trump is someone that has been working on that trail. And ever since he has been elected the President of the United States of America, he has been working towards it with a couple of reforms that he has made. Yeah, he practically went with a showdown with the House of Representatives. You remember that time when there was a shutdown in the United States of America for about 30 days. And aside that, most of the policies that he has ruled out, the DACA program that intends to punish, in the United States of America, going back this time around, if you come into the country with children, let's say kids right now, if you're actually detained and your case is being heard in the courts, whether you are going to be repatriated and sent back to your country, there's a particular program called the DACA program that is going to take your children, and the state is actually going to be catering for your children until your case is heard. So President Donald Trump came and said, this is nonsense. I mean, we shouldn't be catering for the children of immigrants. And that was signed in Barack Obama's tenure, and he actually opted to stop it. But the court actually ruled last week that he shouldn't put an end to that program. Yeah, one of the things he tried to do then again was that if you're an immigrant and you are caught, instead of allowing you to, you know, live your normal life while your case is being heard, he ordered that, you know, they should be arrested and kept in federal prisons until their case are heard also. And one of the things he did, I remember last year, was that if you are arrested anywhere near the border in the United States of America, originally you should have an access to lawyer to hear your case. But if you are arrested near the U.S. border, President Donald Trump actually wanted to sign a bill then that will see that you are deported immediately without you having access to lawyer. So, since staying true to his claim, he has done something related to that, as President Donald Trump bans H-1B visas and green cards till the end of this year. Yeah, in order to bar the entry of immigrants into the United States of America, President Donald Trump orders the freeze of H-1B visas and H-4 visas used by technological workers and their family, as well as L visas for intra-company transfers and multi-day visas for work and study abroad programs through to the end of the year. Yeah, once again, United States President Donald Trump signed an order on Monday suspending the temporary work visas, including H-1B visas for foreigners until the end of the year, in order to ban the entry of immigrants in the U.S., the new H-1B visas and the H-4 visas. This particular category of visa is actually used by technology workers and their family. So H-1B visa and H-4 visa. So if you are a technology person and you want to go to the United States of America to work based on, you know, technology, the visa you are likely going to apply for is the H-1B visa and the H-4 visa. President Donald Trump is putting a stop to it right now. And also, L visas for intra-company transfers. Intra-company transfers. And also, J visas for work and study abroad programs. And also, the application of green cards. He has suspended those visas and the application of green card up until December 31, 2020. So if you have a relative, a family listening in that is in the United States of America right now, they probably might not have access to getting green cards for this main period of time. And you are probably someone that is willing to secure visas to the United States of America. These sets of visas are actually, you know, being suspended. H-1B and H-4 visas for technological people, L visas for intra-company transfers, and J visas for people that are looking to go and study and work in the United States of America. Quickly, still in the United States of America, how I would have loved to talk about John Bolton's book. Did I say president? I mean, John Bolton's book. He's a former national security advisor to the president of the United States of America. He was asked to resign just some couple of months ago, and he has come out with a tell-all, a book that he has been revealing quite a whole lot of secrets about the President Trump presidency and our happenings in the White House while he was working for the president. The title of the book is The Room Where It All Happened. Yeah, quite a lot of indicting claims and quite a lot of secrets that are supposed to be kept are actually revealed in that book. And I would have loved to, you know, touch lights and talk about some of the issues. We definitely take my time, but it's 2:52 p.m. in the studios of King FM. I probably will not be have the time to break down every facet of that particular book to you. So maybe we suspend it, and some couple of editions in the show, we try to bring them to you. Okay, I have this excerpt, more like a voice clip, more like a documentary put together to try and make us understand a little bit of what it's all about and what the room where it all happened, the title of the book, as its contents.
John Bolton writes his former boss is erratic, foolish, irrational, stunningly uninformed. Then he gets to his foreign relationships.
I think Putin thinks he can play him like a fiddle. I think Putin is smart, tough, I think he sees that he's not faced with a serious adversary here. I don't think he's worried about Donald Trump.
John Bolton describing a meeting at the G20 summit in Osaka last year. China's President Xi complaining to President Trump about China critics in the U.S.
Yeah, we have to suspend that, actually. Quite a lot of indictments. I mean, we've all believed that President Donald Trump hates China and hates President Xi Jinping, but the book revealed, you know, another thing entirely. And Nigeria, to some extent, was also talked about in the book about stopping funding for Nigeria and some African countries too. But unfortunately, I wouldn't be able to go more than that. Okay, moving forward quickly, in the South Korean peninsula, it was celebrated this week, June 25, that was yesterday, the 70th year anniversary of the Korean War. The 70th year anniversary of the Korean War. And in case you don't know much about the Korean War, I have a voice clip here that more like details what happened in the Korean War that broke out on the 25th of June 1950 up until July 1953.
Korean War, June 25th, 1950 through July 27th, 1953. At the end of World War II in 1945, Korea was freed from Japanese control. North Korea was occupied by the Soviets while the South was occupied by American forces. By 1948, the country was divided in half at the 38th parallel, with the capitalist South ruled by Syngman Rhee and the communist North ruled by Kim Il-sung. The Soviet troops withdrew from Korea in 1948 and U.S. troops withdrew in 1949. However, North and South Korea, as enemies of one another, would not accept the border between them as permanent. The North Koreans attacked South Korea on June 25, 1950, advancing across the 38th parallel. Around 75,000 troops of the North Korean People's Army defeated the Republic of Korea's army with success, capturing the capital city of Seoul, then occupying the whole of South Korea except for Busan. This was a problem, as President Truman and the United States wanted to contain the spread of communism by preventing the domino effect. That is, if Korea fell, so would other countries to the ideology. South Korea appealed for support, and the United States pushed a resolution through the United Nations Security Council. The USSR did not use its veto power, as it was boycotting the council because the new communist China was not accepted. In China's seat was the pro-U.S. Chinese nationalist government of Taiwan. An appeal was made by the Security Council for North Korea to withdraw its troops, but was ignored. As a result, approval was granted for a UN army made up of an international force of 16 nations to send help to South Korea, commanded by General Douglas MacArthur. The UN troops, composed mainly of Americans, landed in South Korea in early July, but were soon pushed back on the defense by the North Korean forces, forming a perimeter around Busan to defend the line until reinforcements arrived in August. Now that their position was strengthened, MacArthur went on the offensive. On September 15th, the U.S. Marines X Corps launched an amphibious assault at Incheon. The North Korean troops were pushed back on the retreat over the 38th parallel, and soon Seoul was recaptured along with the whole of South Korea by the end of the month. Now, MacArthur was to go beyond the initial idea of containment. Truman, worried of a Chinese response, nevertheless approved, and UN troops moved into North Korea on October 7, 1950. On October 12th, they captured Pyongyang, the North Korean capital, and then the Yalu River, which was the border with communist China. China retaliated by helping the North Koreans, sending 250,000 Chinese troops. The UN troops, overwhelmed by this new force, were pushed out of North Korea with heavy losses. By January 1951.
Okay, more like a documentary put together to help us understand what transpired in the Korean Peninsula War that broke out between the North Korea and South Africa. The 70th year anniversary was actually celebrated yesterday, the 25th day in the month of June 2020, and it was a very big parade with, you know, quite a lot of things that was engulfed in it, drama, a military parade, the president of the country coming to pay homage, and some veterans of the war actually, you know, paid respect to 70 years ago. Okay, time is fast spent. I have to get myself out of the studios right now. But before I go, this last piece of news coming from Uzbekistan. Yeah, Uzbekistan is one of the countries in the world that makes quite a whole lot of money from tourism. As in people coming to their country to tour and as tourists. So Uzbekistan, due to the current pandemic and the coronavirus ravaging the world, have not been able to make, you know, a lot of money from tourism. And they have been able to suppress the virus in their country. Now they are opening their borders to tourists once again. And they are telling people, don't worry, we are free right now. You can come to our country to come and tour, you know, to come and have a nice time, to come and relax. And according to reports, they are offering, they are willing to offer to anybody 50,000 in their currency to anyone who gets the coronavirus while visiting their country. Yeah, so from my investigation, I got to know that the total prize money that they are actually, the total money they are actually trying to offer anybody who gets the virus in their country is about $3,000. Convert that to Nigerian money, probably a little bit over, you know, a couple of a million naira. So they are saying, we have opened our borders, come on, come and have fun, come and tour in our land. We are opening our borders to tourists once again. And in case you come and you get affected with coronavirus, we are going to be giving you $3,000 to see through the treatment. I am Ajibola Samuel. I have to get myself out of the studios right now. Have a wonderful weekend ahead of you. Stay safe. Maintain social distancing. Use hand sanitizers, face mask when necessary. Don't shake anybody. Avoid large gatherings. I'm Ajibola Samuel. Au revoir.